Hello, everyone. It's Saturday again. Why is Saturday coming so fast? Someone told me that the older you are, the days coming faster at you because you are older, so your time reference to the past is different than the newborn. Newborn look at tomorrow as forever, but for us, it is next second. So here again on Saturday, and we kept our promise. Today, what we want to talk about is what if you want to close your business? It is never a really easy subject to talk about, but folks, I want you to remember, every time when we talk about business opening, business closing, business acquisition, and business selling, none of that we should really attach too much of emotion to. Because it is a matter of how you move to the next stage of your life, right? So I don't look at a business closing as total failure at all. Sometimes business closing is for something better. Sometimes business closing is a change of lifestyle. So really, and before you close, and don't have any psychological burdens related to, oh, I'm closing a business. I don't want to talk to Ying, and she would think that I am not that great. Absolutely not necessary. You talk to me and I will think for you. And a business closing is a matter of a decision we need to make. But before you make that decision, I want to talk to you about what you need to know and pay attention to, especially right now. If you want to close a business, you probably got a lot of government subsidized dollars already, like your PPP, like your shuttered venue grant, like your RRF, all of these monies. What do they do to you? And can you really close without thinking about them? So I'll give you the answer today. So let's follow the PowerPoint we prepared for you, and I will start sharing screen, right? And yes, right? So that is so much about our firm and myself, and no responsibility disclaimer is always a standard slide. We always show up right here for you and make sure that you're responsible for what you are doing with our information. Okay, so now let's start. And how do I know I should close? It is $1 million questions. Nobody really gonna know whether you're gonna close or not. But this is a couple of factors, indicators. I want to give that to you because these are the most popular indicators that when client communicated with us, they either close or they even file the bankruptcy or they close because there's a huge buyer coming in. These are interesting factors that in the decision-making process becoming important. So we always say that if five of these factors are with you, and then you're considering closing is very normal. And look, so 10 indicators, out of the 10 indicators, you own five or more today, and you should think of selling or closing. Okay, number one, lack of profit for extended period. And if you are lacking a profit, obviously you're putting in your own money to run the operation. How far do you go? Are you gonna put in all of the 30 years saving into this not running business? And when are you gonna call it done? So that is, when I say extended period, I'm not talking about 2 months. I'm not talking about 3 months. I am talking about a year and 2 years. And our business owners really drag it. They're not making it. They think next year gonna be better. So you really want to know that, okay, I am not making it for the last 3 years already. Then let's look, ongoing compliance issue. Some people are in the businesses that are highly compliant, compliance level, compliance requirement is high. For example, if you are in the car dealership kind of business, if you are in the money cashing business, or you're in the restaurant business that you just don't have a good habit to keep your kitchen up to date and clean. So you are going into compliance issue all the time. When you have this kind of compliance issue, it indicates that your business management have a big issue. The business management issue may not be your employee issue, might just be you, and you yourself yourself doesn't really have the kind of mindset to put that as a priority. So you're in a high compliance environment, but you're not really taking that very seriously. Then you have this ongoing issue that is very costly. And I would tell my client that if you're so creative, there's no rules confound you. And you're just creative in so many ways that you have a hard time to confine yourself into a certain running of the business. Maybe this business is not for you, right? So ongoing compliance issue indicates a unfitness for yourself. It's almost like, you know, if you're running for miles, but you got 100 pounds on yourself, so you don't fit for that type of running. So it's nothing right or wrong. We need creative souls to have creative things happen in the world, right? But that doesn't mean that you can use those creativity in this kind of area. So really, you know, I want attorneys and accountants to be creative, to be smart, but I don't want them to be creative because that is opposite to what we need it. We need to be in compliance, right? So that is why I put that there, because small business owners, a lot of the small business owner, when they are coming from outside of the country, maybe their country where they were born and grow up, it doesn't have a very good rules and regulations. But when they come to US to do business, they did not really have that culture to follow these kind of things. So they are going into compliance issue all the time. So consider that if you have that element in your business, maybe it is not a right business for you. There are businesses that have less compliance requirement. Okay. Not all business is the same. Cash flow issue and the lending hurdles. Cash flow issue just basically today is a payday and you just don't have money for payroll. Okay. And because your cash flow is short, so when you go to the bank, ask for a line of credit, and they may not want to give that to you. You know, it's kind of counterintuitive, right? You're like, because I short of money, that's why I go to the bank. They should just give that to me. No, it's not like that. And this is where sometimes we say that the rich get richer, the poor get poorer, because, you know, the system is not really rewarding the one that you don't have cash, I give you. In fact, it says that if you have more cash, I give you more cash. Do you want more? So that's how, generally speaking, the system is designed to act like that way. Maybe not on purpose, but that's what the result is, right? So your cash flow issue and a lending hurdle, that is always your issue. You're in the wrong business. You need to figure out why that is the case. Creditor pressures. Okay, you loaned money already and you just couldn't pay it. Or you have a line of credit already, but you maximized it and you haven't even paid back for 3 years. So that is a pressure point. That should be something you consider. Business trend is no longer something you can do. For example, and a very good example, 20 years ago, shoe repair shop is really a very sweet spot for one person operation, repairing shoes and sitting in the corner of the mall or some street, and it can stay there for 10, 20 years, people just gonna go. You know, even, you know, my daughter, and she was wearing a pair of shoes, so worn, so bad. And she wanted to wear that, so she go to the shoe repair shop. First of all, you can't even find one. Finally, she found one. They told her to throw the shoes away. So, you know, but that business used to be very good. So now with the situation, our society progressing, who is repairing the shoes anymore? They just toss it. The shoes manufacturing knows that one shoe doesn't need to last forever. One summer is okay. So the shoes are made quicker. Shoes are made cheaper. Shoes are made to throw away, right? With all of that, business trends are actually going away from you. Maybe the business you're in is just outdated business, okay? Labor shortage. Who doesn't know that? And I know every one of you who are with me right now, and you would raise your hand if I ask you, you know what I mean by labor shortage. And this entrepreneurship that we have in our head, and we're teaching everybody about entrepreneurship, nobody wants to be employees anymore. So everyone wants to be independent. Everyone wants to be entrepreneur. So you have a hard time to get your labor. But You know, if the government don't require us to hire labor, you don't have any problem. For a restaurant, and if they are server and a waiter, waitress and a waiter, and you have to pay payroll, you have to do W-2. You cannot run 1099 NEC, right? So the labor requirement is there. So you cannot hire anybody else but laborers, but yet labor market is not really there for you. So there is a conceptual, a mental stage of human beings versus the market need of our society, it's just not matching. So labor shortage, if it is so severe for you and you have struggling that for many, many years, you want to reconsider, remap your business, maybe get into a business that doesn't need a labor, doesn't need anybody else, and just you, your spouse, and your kid, right? And the pricing structure is no longer working. Nobody's pricing structure is working right now. And we, you know, I was working with a restaurant owner trying to increase their menu price because their supply increased by 34% in purchase price. So it used to be costing $100, now is $134. So how could they not raise their price on the menu? But we come to the point that our business owner will go, no, Ying, I cannot raise anymore. I would lose all of our clients. There's nobody going to come to my restaurant to eat if you make me do the price structure. So that just means that the price structure is not working. With the supply price going up, and we're sitting here, business owners are sitting here, are trying to absorb the shock, right? So the price is increasing. We got more expensive stuff. But on the customer side, we couldn't really push it out to increase the price because the customer are devastated. And you have the food stamp already dropped. So people don't have money. You're going to have people starving if you are starting raising your price like that. So there you go. The pricing structure doesn't work. But for some business, you can still pass it on. But for some business, you just can't. So that is another factor for people to close or to sell. And the litigation. If you already got into litigation, litigation drags on, draining all your cash, then it's another thinking, right? Whether you should just leave or close. Personal circumstances changed. You know, got divorced and got married. During the pandemic, had 5 new babies. And I mean, there's so many things you can, you know, making you not able to run your business. These are indicators. If you have more than 5 of them, you are for sure looking at either selling and closing. Of course, if buyers knocking your door, wanting to buy you, and, you know, or your employees stepped up wanting to buy into the shares, that's where you are working on selling, you're working on closing, the same thing. Let's say if one of your employee and they walk up to you goes, hey, I want to be a partner and I want to buy in the business, right? And our recommendation is that to still close your existing business and open up a partnership and to run the business, but don't continue on the same playground just because you want to cut off the impact you may have from the PPP, from the ERC, RF, all of these things. So let's go to see what we need to know when we close a business. Normally, when you close a business, you have these 3 things to look at. Okay, normally, and the federal level, state level, and also dissolution, dissolve the state registration. So that's the thing you need to do, right? So on the federal level, you need to file the final tax return, and you need to cancel your payroll-related registrations, and then you need to file the final for 941, 940, and also W-2, W-3. If you did all of that, you're done with the federal closing. But for the state level, you of course also file final tax return. So you're going to accomplish that at the same time. File that tax return, mark final for both federal and the state, right? And you want to cancel your payroll account with the state withholding, with your workforce, with the UI, unemployment insurance, right? And you also want to file your sales tax permit, sales tax return final, and with a cancellation of that permit. So those are normal steps and we need to close. And then you go ahead to dissolve your entity at the Secretary of State. some people said to me that, Ying, no, that's not right. And I don't have to dissolve it. I just, you know, I know that I just leave it and it will be dissolved by itself. That is so true. It's called administrative dissolution. It's administratively dissolved. And that administratively dissolved is equal to a missing person. If you go to file dissolution, it is equal to a death certificate. So do you want a missing person or you want a death certificate in the case this person is no longer here? I would prefer to have a death certificate so I know that person is finished, is done. And instead of having a missing person, God knows 20 years later, this person will come to life. Right? So same thing on your business registration with the state. If you do not dissolve, your administratively dissolved, it can always come back for whatever reason. Okay. Could be someone using your identity fraudulently and go back to do something to your company. So you don't want to have that missing person status having it properly dissolved. So those are normal steps, right? Then what is new with pandemic money? So now we're closing, let's say we close in 2022. What happened to all these past pandemic dollars that I got, right? So all small businesses should seek and complete all possible PPP loans application and EIDL loan, and for EIDL loan to get that finished before closing. So all of your PPP is a loan, right? It can be forgiven. So that's why, you know, on this slide, and I wrote down that PPP that you don't need to pay back, but you need to apply for forgiveness. By now, I would assume all of you in this webinar, and you already finished your PPP. You already got forgiven. And you already spend your PPP dollars properly on payroll, on mortgage interest, on rent, utility, all of these things that PPP is supposed to pay for, right? And you want to make sure that that is done. That is behind you. If you haven't really got the total forgiveness yet, I would say hold on to your horses and don't close yet. Close it when you get PPP all forgiven. And the money you spent, is the record is with you. And look at the last sentence. You need to keep that record for 6 years, even though you closed it in 2022. So that means by the summer of 2028, and you close right now, then by the summer of 2028 and after, you can close, you can throw away your PPP related document, right? So that is one. And going back to the opening slides here, and so the forgiveness is something that once you are forgiven, and you don't need to consider that anymore. So it's water under the bridge, and you don't have to consider, you don't need to pay it back. It's forgiven. It's forgiven, period, forever, and never look back, right? And then you have all of these other ones. So you borrow, you have PPP loan. You have IRRF grant and EIDL loan and ERC refund. And look at how I put them. And your state grants. So I'll say that again. PPP loan, RF grant, EIDL loan, ERC refund. So all of these, because of the lending of that word, loan or grant, refund, so it triggers different treatment. So for PPP, it's a loan. Normally loan, you have to pay it back, but now we're saying, no, you don't need to pay it back if you got forgiveness application in and already approved. So we mentioned to you that you have to use the PPP money this way. There's no other way. Can't buy a Lamborghini. No, that's not part of PPP usage, okay? All right, RRF. Restaurant Revitalization Fund is a grant, does not need to be repaid, and no forgiveness application is even needed. It is yours, you got it. Before you close your business, you will want to make sure you spend your funds on the approved expenses. You spent. Spent. That's a past tense. Okay? And not that you will spend. No, you done. You used it. Okay? Otherwise, you will need to pay back the remainder grand if you close right now. Let's say you got a $3 million RRF. And in 2021, on December time, remember we have already done the RRF annual report for you. So you already spent, say, $1 million. Now in 2022, you want to close. And you only spent another million, you still have a million left. That need to be paid back to SBA. Because you closed it, you didn't use it, so you return it. So we say that you will need to pay back the remainder grand, and the approved expenses are the following. I made a list of that for you just because I need you to know that you have to spend RF funds in this fashion and keep the record for 6 good years. And so that way, even if you close your company later, when SBA come back and knocking your door for compliance review, and you're not telling them that, oh, sorry, I closed my business. Everything got burned because I just decided to burn my past so I can have a new beginning. No, it doesn't work that way, folks. You need to save how you spend it, right? Same thing with this one, Shattered Venue Operator Grant. This is a grant, not a loan. This is kind of mirror. RRF has the list of the expenses you can use for. This is more for the theaters, the entertainment, people in that industry, right? Same thing. If you don't spend, you pay it back. And you can close, but if you spend it according to the list, then you will be fine, right? Now, let's look at EIDL. EIDL is a loan too. PPP is a loan, right? And RF is a grant. SVOG is a grant. EIDL loan. EIDL, that L is a loan. Is economic. Just suddenly forgot about what I stand. Injury. Is an injury disaster loan. So it is a loan that giving out for disasters, not just for COVID, and it could be for earthquake and the mountain burning, all of these stuff that California has. So SBA does not offer forgiveness program for disaster loans, period. Okay, so we don't need any special rules because disaster loans has always existed with the SBA, just wasn't so massively used like COVID-19 time. So these loans must be prepaid over 30 years and with interest rate up to 8%. So EIDL loan during COVID time was marked at 3.75. It would not go up to 8, okay? But generally speaking, the disaster loans can go up to 8%. There were two parts to EIDL loan program during the COVID time in 2020, 2021, folks. Do you remember we have two parts in this loan? One is grant, the other one is loan. Remember that? So there was a targeted advance grant coming in that in the very beginning, it was like 1,000 per employee up to 10,000. You remember that, folks? That is a grant. So that means what? That means if you close the company, as long as you used it, you don't need to pay it back, okay? But what about later on, they did this supplemental targeted advance. You remember that, folks? You know, there is a targeted advance. This is the 10,000 maximum one. Then they also did this one called supplement targeted advance. This is like 5,000 additional money they gave that to you. And these two are together. The maximum you can get was 15,000. That 15,000 is grand. So you don't need to pay it back. You just need to use it properly based on the guidance. So it tells you how you're gonna use it, okay? So spend on working capital, operating expense, spend on healthcare benefit, rent, utility, fixed debt payments, all right? So this is the grand part. But of course, there is also the loan part. Remember that loan part can go all the way up to 2 million be the maximum. Remember that? So that is the 2 million that is not forgivable. So if you are going to close the company, that $2 million loan is still yours. Okay. So now let's look at the detail with, you know, some people got less than 20,000. Some people got less than 200,000. Some people got 2 million. So are they all the same? So let's look at that. So ELDL of 25,000 or less do not require collateral or personal guarantee. So in the vast majority of default on these small loans, business owner personal assets will not be at risk of seizure. So that means, that just simply means that if you borrow the EIDL loan that is under 25,000, you did not sign any personal guarantee notes and there's no collateral to your business property. So if you close your business and you default on the loan and you default on the loan because business closed, there's no recourse to you and go knocking your door and taking your car away from you. All right. But if your loan is between 25,000 to 200,000, you see that right there. For example, that do require collateral, but generally collateral is a business property. So which means that is your inventory, is your asset, things like that. So if you are closing the business because you are just insolvent and you're just not doing good, or you even file bankruptcy for your business, then that would definitely go away just because the collateral is on your business. If the business has no asset or business do have an asset, then you will sell the asset and pay the creditor, right? So that is between 25,000 to 200,000. But what if you got more than 200,000 up to 2 million? And that is both collateralized on the business and on your personal property. So what does that mean if it is on me personally? You know, one thing I want to mention to you that your federal government tax refund, like the tax refund you got from IRS, that's your personal property. And if you borrow money and you don't pay, you default on the loan, and even though it is SBA, but that can go to your IRS account, and whatever refund you got is going to be SBA's property, because that is your property, you use your property, collateralize your loan, right? What happens? So I want to lay it out for you. And if you are closing the business because the devastated stage you're in and you just don't have money, business is going down and you just cannot pay that anymore. So then you are looking at six things I want you to know. Number one, your collateral is at risk, whether it's your business collateral or your personal. So whatever you use, so you need to go back to your EIDL loan to start reading in the fine print and see what's included in there. Okay, other collateral may be at risk too, because you maybe co-signed that with another person and that person probably don't even remember he signed it. Too bad, not very good. And that person's personal property, everything would also subject to collateral, also subject to collection. Okay, SBA will demand a repayment. So SBA has every right to send you letters and demanding letters and months after months and saying that you owe me more, you owe me even more. So you will continue getting those kind of letters because even though your business closed, but because you're personally liable, so it is going to go into your personal name. It's going to follow you to wherever you move to because it's on you now, on you personally. The SBA will take legal actions, of course. You know, if you don't pay loan and you're personally guaranteed, you got a bunch of properties out there and you think SBA doesn't know. No, the government has every access to your property and they will and take legal action to seize your property, right? And your credit score will go bad and our business owners, when we are in that situation, you probably not only default on EIDL loan, you may be defaulting on other banks' loan. And they, obviously will affect your a score, your business credit score. So here I want folks to know that the bankruptcy chapter 7, like personal bankruptcy, and it takes 7 years to get out of your record. So if you bankrupt, and it will show on your record. Every time they pull out your credit report, it will show that you actually filed bankruptcy. So it will make it really hard for you to borrow money from anybody, from bank. And unless if you borrow money from your friend, they just know you, that's a different story. They don't read your credit report. But if you want to do business, you want to get into a big project, need investors to come in to you, need bank to put in the money, forget it when you credit score becoming impacted by this, right? And your tax return from IRS will be paid to, your tax refund from IRS will be paid to SBA. So that's another, when you default, and this is what happens when that is linked to your personal. All right, so now let's look at our next one is ERC. Employee retention credit, folks. And if your business got shut down during the pandemic time, if your operation was affected by the social distancing, all of these things, and you want to know that you might be eligible for ERC. And if you haven't really done any study for yourself and you don't know whether you have it or not, I want you to give us a call at our firm. And we have Dr. Hao and doing that for, you know, leading a team to do ERC credit for clients that we, you know, we actually never met. It's new clients. We are the places that really answer a lot of those questions. And we have a very good team to work that for you if you don't know whether you're qualifying or not. And with this ERC, I want you to remember earlier when I was saying ERC, do you remember I said ERC refund? So ERC refund just means that that was your money. That was your money you paid, you're getting it back. So when you close the company, does that affect that? Of course not, because that's the money you paid from before. So you're just getting it back. But of course, if you're closing the company today, we want to tell you that, you know, yes, ERC is a refund, it's not a grant, but you still have to do the following things. Keep your company bank open, because the check gonna come into you with the company name and the company EIN number. You can't afford to close your bank account. Where are we gonna deposit the money? Right? So you want to give time, don't close your bank account. Do not dissolve the entity at the Secretary of State and make sure that it's still active. So that way the bank would not close your account. Because if you are missing person at SOS, and then, you know, the bank institution can submit your account to missing person list, so you won't even have a right to it. So make sure you don't dissolve the entity, keep it active. And this is the third one is the deal. You need to amend your final year tax return with the refund amount. So let's say, you know, you got a refund for 2020, you got a $100,000 refund, okay? Then you need to go back to your 2020, amending your taxes. What do you amend? You only amend the payroll expense, because the payroll expense in 2020 is $100,000 overstated. So you want to reduce your expense, therefore you increase your income, right? So you've got to save a little money for yourself to pay income tax. So I want to make sure that I mentioned that to you, and you need to file your final return with the ERC credit all in it. Don't leave the ERC credit out, because you could get a check and then your tax return is done. That's not a good deal. Okay, you need to know that you are responsible to make sure your tax return is being amended. All right, so now we covered the whole slew of the federal grants, right? And you know that how that impacts you when you close. And I want to touch on the state grants. The state grants are so many varieties. Sometimes you get grants from nonprofit, you got grants from the state, you got funds from the state, different department, right? All of them, what you really need to know, look at my slides. I said you need to read your document to find out the grants require you to pay back or not, okay? If you close, it will say something about that. and read your document to find out if you can close the business and how long of the waiting time you have to close, right? Eligibility on the expenses is also key. Keep 10 years, folks, 10 years for the state, okay? The state has much longer time than the federal, and you keep for 10 years. All right, final words on closing, final words. Closing a business doesn't have to be a failing. It is not so. And some business close strategically. So it is your job to know that it's time to close and it is properly closed, okay? Here are some tips for closing. Get on top of your cash flow to start building emergency budget. This one, I said that one is because more likely if you got your ERC refund and you go back to amend your tax return, you're gonna end up paying taxes. So you really cannot ignore that. That's part of your responsibility. So make sure that you start building your cash flow. And the prioritize SBA loan, the one you personally guaranteed, or any loan that you personally guaranteed, and you, unless you're gonna file your personal bankruptcy as well, then you cannot get away. So you want to get them paid, right? Reduce the money you are taking out of the business to free the funds for repayment. Don't take the money out without knowing how much of a repayment you need to do. So make sure that you plan your money and reduce your business expense. If you know you're gonna close, certain expenses you know you're not gonna pay. So don't pay that. And if you are going to close, right? Don't buy more supplies and don't expand on inventory building. You don't need that. And if you don't think that you will be able to make repayment, you want to contact your SBA office as soon as possible. Tell them that, hey, look, I'm planning to close the business. I have a EIDL loan and who should be my contact and I want to work that out, right? And make sure you keep your finance clear and clear. No incidents, don't lose the record because the pandemic related funding has its own compliance requirement. I'm not even talking about IRS audit. Of course, that one requires you to save all your notes, right? But I am talking about pandemic related money. All of them are subject to compliance review. You can't afford to not have those documents. And look at the loan you have on hand, knows that which one comes to, you know, number one, because some of the loan, for example, maybe you have an EIDL loan that is not collateralized on your personal because it's under 200,000, but you have another loan with other banks that is collateralized on your personal. So you know what is the priority to pay off, because if it is connected to you personally, that probably is your priority, right? And speak to an accountant or a lawyer or someone you trust. Speak to community CPA about your plan and have us be involved with evolving yourself into another species. And I mean, you know, I look at this kind of transactions as a way for some business entrepreneurs coming out of their hardship so they can relive their normal life. And sometimes it's a strategic direction and business are taking to consolidate, to merge and to acquire. So those are closings are rather exciting because you're looking at a better future or you are strategically planning that to be the case. So, you know, closing a business doesn't have to be a depressing moment. It can be a moment that you're looking at scaling your business to the future. But of course, your creditors is the one that you need to take care of them. So they don't, no creditors want to, you know, walk away quietly because they realize that you're scaling your business. You're not really in hardship. You just want to close to get rid of me. They will not let that happen. So make sure that you consider all your, you know, I don't know, I forgot the English word for it, but in Chinese we call it 棋子. You know, you consider all your moves on the thing. So like chess games, right? Why am I forgetting English words? But anyway, I think this is my end of today, I do have something coming up on the question, and there is a question from someone saying that, is this in general for defaulting on loan 25,000 or less? Not for general, because what I am talking about, the 25,000 and less, is the EIDL loan. If you remember going on internet and apply for EIDL loan back in 2020 and 2021, and then later on, earlier this year, you could even increase that to 2 million. And if you borrow the EIDL loan, economic injury, disaster injury loan, and you know, it's for disaster, it's for the COVID-19, that loan, if it is under 25,000, you have no collaterals. It is just a loan. And if you close, and it won't follow you to your personal life. I hope that answered your question. And thank you everyone for here with me. We have quite a few people today online, so we knew that it's needed topic for everyone. And don't be shy to share our YouTube channel, because this particular webinar will be on YouTube channel in 24 hours. So if any friends, anybody are thinking of closing and they didn't know where to begin, send them this video so that they can kind of understand how that related to those pandemic dollars they got from the government. I will talk to you again. And next Tuesday is my short webinar. I'm going to talk about improving IRS. Join me on Tuesday. If IRS has anything that making you feel they should improve, and coming to the session, so I will explain to you how to go about improving IRS. Talk to you again. Bye-bye.